Hey everybody, we are chilling out on a very rainy day at the new Mad Priest location downtown with Michael here. Say hey.
Hi.
First of all, tell people where this is.
We are on Cherry Street between 7th and 8th, right next to Burns Tobacco and CBC.
There you go. So I've been here for a little while having a cappuccino. The cool thing that we notice about this new location is there is an addition to the coffee, which is what? What's different here?
Well, I guess versus just having a coffee shop, we wanted to expand into a full specialty beverage retail space. So obviously, kind of the secondary focus is cocktails. We also have a very intentional beer lineup as well. And a lot of that just comes down to the fact that, for me, a lot of these things overlap. When you talk about beverages being crafted from similar products being produced and then finalized through some sort of like either roasting or distillation or brewing, and then the barista bartender being the final product. So we kind of wanted to become a more holistic specialty beverage place. So.
Okay, cool. And we were talking about earlier, I said I hadn't really seen other places that have coffee and then cocktails, and you were saying you travel around a lot and really haven't either. I was wondering.
Yeah, I mean, there's definitely several places that have both to some extent, but the 100 bars and coffee shops I went to this year, the few that were doing it usually either focus more heavily on one or the other. We really wanted to try to come at it with the focus on both. Obviously, the struggle of that is long hour days and the right staff who are experts in those areas and being able to maintain that, things like that. So it'll be a challenge, no doubt, but we're ready to take it on. So.
What are the hours?
So we're going to open at 7 a.m. every day, except Saturday will be 8. Sundays we're closed. And then during the week, we'll play with the hours, probably 10 or 11 p.m. And then the weekend's midnight. So.
And what are we making? What is Jen making?
So Jen is going to be making one of our coffee cocktails called the Pasha.
Okay.
It obviously has a little bit of cold brew concentrate in it. It has a rye base, whiskey rye, and a little bit of Tempest Fugit cacao. What else we got in it, Jen?
Rittenhouse rye, Rittenhouse cacao, Punta Mace, which is a vermouth, and Chinar, which is an Amaro, cold brew, and an ancho chocolate saline, and an ancho chocolate
rim. Salted rim.
That's good. And you guys also have food here, right?
We do, yeah. We have a small kitchen, but we wanted to offer something during the day for breakfast and lunch. Pretty simple, nothing too carb heavy or protein focused, just sandwiches, salads, simple breakfast items. And then at night, we wanted to focus more on that communal experience, so a lot of shared plates. So kind of European-style tapas, one plate should, you know, feeds 2 to 3 people. So a lot of international inspiration in the food there.
And I see, I think you mentioned beer and wine, too.
Yeah, so our wine list will be a little limited. We'll definitely have some bubbles as well by the bottle. Our beer, we really wanted to focus more on that imported side of things. So we have a lot of Belgians that we're going to carry, a lot of the heavier doubles, triples, and strong ales, and bring some of the things that you're not going to see as often around the city, like Delirium Tremens or St. Bernardus and things like that.
Cool. And for those of you who don't know, a lot of people talk about the mission and the story behind Mad Priest. You want to tell people about that?
Yeah, sure. So that's probably the number one question we get is, who's the Mad Priest? Why is it named that? I was in front of the beer board early this morning, and that was their first question before we even talked about beer stuff. I was like, what's the name? The name comes from the Count of Monte Cristo, the novel by Alexandre Dumas, 18th century. It takes place during the French Revolution, but basically in the novel there is the old priest in the prison, Abbe Faria. The prison guards refer to him as the Mad Priest because they didn't believe that he had a treasure. And he was like so brilliant that he was a little crazy. But the Abbe was basically the one who trained and educated Edmund, who was kind of just an uneducated sailor, and is the one who basically allowed him to escape, get the treasure, have a life. So when we started the business, we wanted to have a triple bottom line. You know, you have your bottom line economically, but you have your environmental and your social. And the social arm initially was focused on refugees. And so kind of that same idea, right? Like you're kind of in this dark place, forced into a situation that you didn't have anything to do with, with seemingly little hope. But then along came this mad priest. And so we wanted to kind of fit that into the narrative of refugees who just really struggle, especially if they actually make it here, which is very few. The ability to socially integrate well is very difficult. So offering jobs, but jobs beyond just manufacturing them, like how do we get them to really feel like they're becoming a part of the community? So yeah, there's several layers, and we've expanded that beyond that to include more local things like displacement on a local level, hiring with a very diverse portfolio, trying to make sure we have a very wide range of staff. And then on the environmental side, we're fully compostable, almost zero waste cafe. I'm just really focused on making sure we can be as responsible as we can on the environmental side.
Cheers to that.
Yeah. Help yourself and try it.
I don't want to spill it. Very good. Strong. Yeah.
So a lot of our house cocktails, though,
like
are their house creations. They they're still riffs on classics, right? Like we always revert back to the classics, which is why the classics. So this is kind of a really nice rendition of the Manhattan with a lot of that kind of fall winter esque feel to it because of the Amaro. Kind of one of the goals is to elevate the beverage industry. So for us, that was finding the people who see this as an actual career path versus like a college job, you know? So most of our staff have been in this industry, whether on the coffee or bar side, for a very long time, and are experts. And so the goal with that, you know, all the way from our roastery, making sure that our roastery has been doing this 8 years, roasting expert coffee, and then the people brewing it have been doing this for a long time, and same thing with the bar side, you know, with Jen running our program, it's been in the industry for 20 years. So we really want people to come in here, and yes, like the ambiance and the atmosphere will give you an experience and hopefully be kind of transported into a new world, but also the quality of the drink unlike any other, and just trying to be the best of the best, more so for the sake of customers experiencing what the potential is for any drink, or what the base spirit or what the base coffee is, optimizing that. So,
that definitely makes a huge difference.
Yeah, and we're even cross-training people. So we found a lot of bar people wanting to learn more about coffee and coffee people about bar, because again, there's that same overlap. Right? And they're excited to just learn about crafting beverages. So.
Very cool. Well, I'm glad you could explain that. You can tell your passion about that.
Yeah.
And in Chattanooga, it's hard to come by. Really, really good service and experience. It's not like a New York, Chicago, where they're career waiters or
that I've
bartenders.
Seen that as a struggle. That was actually one of the reasons we started Mad Priest 2.5 years ago, was I was like, where's the opportunities for me as a professional moving here from a bigger city to excel in this on this path? And so this year, to kind of try to ensure that we can bring excellence to Chattanooga, I went to over 11 cities, over 100 bars, and just said, what is the best from Seattle, from Austin, from Boston, from Atlanta, Nashville, and kind of putting all together in one package here, because I don't think there's any reason why we can't have the same quality here as there are in larger cities. Granted, finding the talent is harder, but that's where we are dedicated to training people. Like, I don't expect people to come with me with 2+ years of bartending experience like most requests would ask. We want to train people who have the right personality, have dedication, and are hard workers. I can train anyone how to be a bartender, but we're looking for the right people to be a part. And we actually, when we designed this bar, both on the coffee and the cocktail side, we ensured that everything was as efficient and healthful as possible for the staff. So we spent a lot of money on the well system so that it was less leaning over and bending over, less impact on the feet, and things like that. Just like the little details that if you do that from the beginning, allow people to be more sustainable. When we designed the space, so back to the novel, when Edmund gets out of prison, he travels the world and kind of collects a lot of those artifacts, so then he sets his home base up on the island. and it brings people there. They're kind of experiencing the world, and you kind of see that throughout the novel. He went all the way to the Far East and back. And that tied in with the cultural aspect of what we do as far as working with refugees and immigrants, as well as just firmly believing that the more exposure to the world that we have, the more we as people can grow and experience the world and be better humans.
Where are you from?
I'm from Atlanta.
Okay.
But I lived abroad for a long time.
Okay.
So a lot of that tied in. Yeah. So we lived in India for a while in the coffee industry. So we wanted to create a space that kind of encompassed a lot of these aspects of the world. So you'll notice when you walk in, we have Moroccan tile up front. You'll notice our bar lights are from India. The lights over the two toppers are from Turkey. The booths are made to kind of be this gothic old Middle Ages style confessional booth. In the back corner, we have an Ethiopian painting from the 30s that kind of tells the story of the Queen of Sheba. But we loved that piece because coffee's from Ethiopia, and then the Queen of Sheba's got this religious tie. Most every detail in here was intentionally placed and collected over the last year, either from just finding it or searching for it. So again, and what's funny is the last week since we soft opened and then grand opened last night, I've heard probably 80 times already. I don't feel like I'm in Chattanooga. And that was the goal. So it's kind of cool to hear people saying it before I even have to say anything, experiencing that. So it's kind of the goal really was Middle Ages meets Ottoman Empire meets French Revolution. And since coffee house has kind of evolved and formulated during the Ottoman Empire in Turkey, we wanted it to return to that same idea of communal revelry, debating, whatever it might be, which is one reason why I put chessboards on the tables, because there's this aspect of communing with someone else over a game of chess. And so we hope this also becomes a staple place for chessboards.
Very cool. That's awesome. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, totally. Appreciate you guys coming.